phase equilibrium would be present. Stress the iron carbon diagram pertains to, and this iron carbon diagram has three such three phase equilibria. That's what you were looking at in the last class. We'll continue with that. In this diagram, this is the pure iron N. This N for Fe3C, which we call cementite. When the phases which are present in steel's iron carbon diagram, they are all rhyming, you know. Ferrite, austenite, cementite, and the mixture of phases also, we'll see that they are all rhyming, right? And so that's not difficult for you to remember that. And here I have 8% carbon. Normally, all these carbon percentages in steel are given in 8%, not in atomic percent. And this here is the temperature. What is the melting point of iron? 1535 degrees centigrade. And this, of course, composition is 6.67% carbon. And we have a peritactic reaction here. As I told you yesterday, my diagram may not be to the scale, because values I shall give you. That's a liquid phase field. Here I have the alpha phase field, gamma phase field. Alpha phase field we call ferrite, gamma we call austenite. This delta phase field we call it delta ferrite. And in between the two single phases, here it will be liquid plus delta, here it will be gamma plus delta, here it will be liquid plus gamma, and that's Fe3C, so it will be liquid plus Fe3C here. Spaces are the small space, I'm not writing that. You should see what is in the left and what is on the right. Those are the two phases present. And here I have alpha plus gamma region, and this is alpha plus Fe3C. I should write this one as a little important. Alpha plus gamma region. And the composition, this is a very small carbon composition, 0.02. That's why I said it's not to the scale. This is 0.8. This is 1.7. This is 4.3. And this composition is 0.5. Sorry, this one liquid is 0.5. And that's 0.18. This one, this is 0.5, and this is 0.1. Where is it? So now these are the compositions, and the temperature here is 1493 degrees centigrade for this equilibrium. Temperature here is 1150 degrees centigrade for eutectic, and for eutectite here the temperature is 725 degrees centigrade. Right. This is the iron carbon diagram, which gives me one peritactic reaction here. One eutectic reaction here, one This is Fe3C, what we call cementite iron, iron carbide diagram, you can say. Fe3C is also called iron carbide. So it's iron carbide diagram, it's not iron carbon diagram. Okay? Right. Another thing which, before I proceed further, I'd like you to notice the difference between the pyrotactic reaction and the eutectic reaction. In three-phase equilibrium, there are three phases and there are three compositions. Composition like this is one is on the left, delta phase, one in the middle is the gamma phase, one on the right is the liquid phase. Similarly, in the eutectic, I have one in the left, the gamma phase, one in the middle is the liquid phase, and one on the right is the cementite Fe3C phase. Between this reaction and this reaction, look at the phase which exists in the middle composition. Here it is gamma, and here that is liquid. This middle composition phase does not exist above the equilibrium temperature anywhere in the diagram. Similarly, here this middle composition phase does not exist below this temperature. How you will be able to identify whether it is a eutectic or a pyrotactic. But there one of the phases should be liquid. If all three phases are solid, this becomes eutectoid and pyrotectoid. You see again eutectoid? The middle combustion phase does not exist below the equilibrium temperature. And the middle combustion phase is gamma, the austenite. It exists above 725 in the diagram. It doesn't exist below 725 degrees. Is this clear? So that's how you can identify the reaction is a eutectic reaction or a pyrotactic reaction, the prefix to the word, whatever we are using. Alright, now what we do is we shall take one alloy, which is a steel, and let us say we take one somewhere here. Let's say this composition is 0.4% carbon. Machine components can be made with this kind of a steel. What happens above this temperature line, which is a dividing line between gamma phase field and a two phase field alpha and gamma? It's all austenite. At this temperature, which is around 1200 degrees centigrade, it is all austenite. 1150, it is all austenite. 1000, 910, up to this temperature, it is all austenite. Before that, it might have gone through this reaction here, the pyrotactic reaction, 0.4%. That's all washed out. But when I have single phase here, that's all washed out. The effect of that is not seen. So I don't talk about that. But when I see the room temperature, or even when I hot roll the steel or hot work the steel, which will be the range of 900,000 degrees centigrade, I don't have to worry about what has happened there. And that is why I said in the last class, this eutectoid reaction is very important for engineers when we want to understand the functioning or the properties of the steels. Before we come to that, we have to see the macrostructure of the steel, what it looks like. So with this alloy of 0.4% carbon, which is to the left of 0.8%, so we call it hypoeutectoid steel. It's not hypo, it is hypo. This hypoeutectoid steel, I shall show you now, its structure in different temperatures, what happens. This is the diagram. That's 0.4%. First, don't worry about that. This is 8% carbon here. This is 0.8 here. And that is 0.02. This is the gamma phase field, alpha phase field, alpha plus gamma phase field. language of necklaces. No, this temperature lines on me. Let's not worry about that. This is usually they call it even temperature. Let's not at the moment worry about it. Keep calling this line as a boundary between a gamma phase field and alpha plus gamma region. Till the temperature, which are above that, let's call this temperature some name. Because I will be talking about this, so let's call it temperature T1. This temperature let's call T2, which is 725 degrees centigrade. You take the temperature. So a temperature which is greater than T1, which could be between 880 or so, 880, 890, something like that, because this is 910 degrees centigrade. 0.84% carbon steel. Or it could be even 840 sometimes, depending upon how the line is going. So this temperature which is greater than T1, it's all single phase, and that single phase, let me show, looks something like this. These are the green boundaries we have, and these are the grains of gamma. Each one is a gamma, okay? That's what happens. The moment I cross T1, let's say I come slightly below T1, because at exactly T1 we know that amount of the second phase is zero. Can apply the liberty fulcrum here. This is the gamma phase weight and this is the alpha phase weight, and you can find out the alpha is going to be proportional to this and gamma is going to be proportional to that. The small quantity of alpha is going to form. But this alpha, so at temperature less than T1, but the temperature is greater than T2. Thus, formation of the alpha phase, transformation we shall look at a little later, but forms usually when the region is, this is solid, where it is energetically favorable for it to do so. When the second phase particle forms in the middle somewhere, let us say it forms like this, it is going to form an interface between this alpha phase which is forming and the gamma phase which already exists there. But the same particle, if I stand here, forms here. It forms the same interface, same area, but removes that much grain bound area. And the maximum grain bound area it removes when it is in the junction. And the same thing if it forms here, it removes less grain bound area only. So it starts from that region, the ungrain bound area is, or any interfacial area means more energy. We want to reduce the energy. Energetically favorable system would be when it forms in the junctions, the new phase. That's more energetically favorable. And then it spreads over to the grain bound regions. When that is formed, then it spreads into the rest of the region. So what happens? Now when the alpha phase forms at the junctions like this. Once it is done, it spreads over into the grain bound region. So this is the alpha phase which is formed, and remaining gamma phase, which is not transformed yet, is still in the middle. Okay, this is still gamma. Or in the middle. And this situation shall run till or not just about T2. And also notice that the at temperature T1, the compression value is 0.4 still, and that of the gamma phase is also 0.4. But the temperature reduces gamma phase field, or the gamma phase follows its composition along this line. And similarly, the alpha phase field from just below this begins to form as of this composition and follows the composition along this line, which is a solidus. Right? It follows along this line. Actually, these should be all called solvus because they're all different solubility limiting solid state itself. So one solvus line is another kind of a solvus line. Right? So this is following along this line, and that is following, the gamma is following composition along this line, and alpha is following the composition along this line. When I can come just about T2, the composition of the alpha phase is 0.02%, and the composition of the gamma phase is 0.8%. And that's the situation I am in. Alpha phase, and well, the other green borders also get covered by the gamma, the alpha phase, which forms like this. And remaining phase area is all gamma. Now it is this gamma. T2, when you cool means you are heat, extracting heat from the system at the same temperature as 725, gamma with 0.8% carbon composition, right? How will it going to solidify rather? Look at this gamma phase of 0.8% carbon. Like the eutectic alloy, this is the eutectoid alloy. And because of this reaction, the reaction which is gamma on cooling, going to form alpha and Fe3C. So, a mixture of alpha and Fe3C forms. We'll show you how this happens in the phase transformations. But this will form in these regions of gamma which are 0.8% carbon. And let us see, those entrapped regions are somewhere here. These are not going to be smooth, round figures. Most of it has all become alpha phase. Okay. So this is going to become now the mixture of alpha and Fe3C. This forming is solid state. When a cemented particle forms, a Fe3C particle forms, it takes carbon from the neighborhood. The neighborhood becomes depleted in carbon. Therefore, let us say this is the boundary, a bigger region. A particle of Fe3C forms like this. So it has taken carbon from here and here. This is depleted, that becomes ferrite. And it cannot get more carbon, so that remains ferrite, but somewhere here, where the carbon has not still come from, it can become another cementite, another cementite like this, along the boundary. But then, if from a forward direction, it can still pick up more carbon and can grow inwards like this. So this is the Fe3C region and this is the alpha region. Ultimately we get alpha and Fe3C, but generally what we find if we cool it in the normal conditions like in air, these boundaries are too near. Under the macroscope, I cannot see them separately. As a result, the whole region looks quite dark to me. But we normally depict this as like this, because the orientations when it forms could be more than one, possibly. Alpha. And also have austenite. If you apply the levering, 3500 polyjectoid alpha, this tell me, composition of the oil is 0.4%. And the composition of the austenite is going to be 0.8%. And composition of the alpha is going to be 0.02%. So which arm of the lever shall give me the mass of the polyjectoid alpha? So let's find that out. M pro alpha. This is equal to, yes, on the other side it will be 0.8 minus 0.4 divided by the total arm of the lever, 0.8 minus 0.02. If I consider 0.02 approximately 0, I can get an approximate answer very quickly. It is 0.4 by 0.8, is about 0.5. 50% is the polyjectoid alpha, and remaining 50% is austenite. So mass fraction of the austenite is going to be again 0.5. At room temperature, or when I cool below 725 degrees centigrade, it is this 50% austenite which becomes perlite. So that's going through the retractite reaction, gamma, on cooling goes to the mixture alpha plus Fe3C. If I have this 0.8%, this is 0.02%, and that is 6.67%, it becomes the perlite. This mixture is a perlite. So this becomes perlite. But in the perlite, how much is ferrite and how much is cementite, that can also be worked out. Alright, let's see that. In perlite, the lever is 0.02, 6.67. And this is 0.8%. This is gamma alpha Fe3C. So in gamma 0.8% composition, this going through this reaction, it forms alpha and Fe3C. I can find out mass fraction of alpha in perlite. Is how much? It's given by this. It is 6.67 minus 0.8 divided by 6.67 minus 0.02, and that shall be 5.87 divided by approximately 6.67. Well, this comes out to be something like 88%. 87% it will turn out to be. Around that. It's just an approximate calculation. Similarly, we can find out what is going to be the fraction of cementite. That will be approximately 0.1213%. Is 1/7 of this thickness approximately. If I cannot see the distance between these two after magnification, there is no question of seeing these two separately. Only at very high magnification I am able to see these as a cementite region, this as a ferrite region. That's why everything looks absolutely dark under normal magnification of 400, 600. Unless I cut this arrangement at a very acute angle, that I shall be able to see. Yeah. The band will be quite wide and we'll be able to see that. It happens rarely. Alright. So now I know this is the perlite, this is the austenite which is going to become perlite. 50%. And 50% is already pro-ejected alpha. So in this alloy, this 50% shall become about approximately 88% of this shall become ferrite, and 12% shall become cementite. Right? So this alloy shall have approximately, sorry, where is it written here? Mass fraction of alpha in perlite, which I actually call now M eutectic alpha, eutectoid alpha, sorry, in, because the eutectoid reaction in the alloy, which is going to be part of the perlite. So whatever I get in the alloy and in the perlite is 0.88 multiplied by, because our austenite itself is 50%, it becomes 0.44. Similarly, in the eutectoid mixture, I have the eutectoid cementite, which will be about 6%, half of 12%. So it is possible for me, knowing how the things are going on in the microstructure, looking at the phase diagram, applying the lever rule, I can find out the fractions of the different constituents in the microstructure. What is in the mixture, what is outside the mixture, everything can be worked out. Right? Alright. So this is how one can go about applying the lever rule and getting the different amounts of different phases. This quantity, which I have worked out like this, can also be worked out. Okay. So where did I go? So of the microstructure, if you recall, this is perlite, which is a mixture of ferrite and cementite, containing rather eutectoid ferrite and eutectoid cementite. And this is the pro-eutectoid alpha. That's what we saw. That's the microstructure of this alloy. So I have the alpha, whether it is from an eutectoid temperature or the temperature higher than the eutectoid temperature, its crystal structure, chemical composition is the same. It's no different. There's no difference between them otherwise. Only thing, the temperature is different. So total alpha, which I have, is equal to pro-eutectoid alpha plus eutectoid alpha. And is it possible to apply the lever to get the total alpha directly? No. system. I have alpha and FEGC at room temperature. So apply the liberal here. And the Fulton there. You can get the total alpha. This is the total alpha. Right? But this layer consists of alpha and FEGC two phases. After I cool it to below 725, this is what it is. So I shall be able to get total alpha. Right? That is how I can also work it out.
Cementate increases in the way, it's
increases, but at the same time it is giving rise to the bitterness in the steam. So when I start from this 0.02%, so almost 0%, go to the right, amount of perlite or the perlite or the cementite, both are increasing as I go from left to right. 100% perlite at 0.8%, and then again now I get the matrix of cementite, which is a very hard metal phase as I go to the right. So as I go from left to right, the hardness of the steel is increasing, because the amount of cementite is increasing. And the very soft material I have is here. Right? That's what decides what will these different variety of steels are used for. We have mild steel in the range of 0 to 0.3% carbon. The low carbon we can use for things like nails, chains, rivets. When you have a little more carbon like 0.2, you can use it for automobile bodies. Ship hulls, reinforcement, in RCC, the buildings you make. Now if I increase more carbon, I will get more cementite, more hardness of the steel, so it will be stronger steel, it will not be so soft, I can use it for machine components. That's called the medium carbon steels. Carbon is between 0.35 to 0.7%, and we can use machine components where the moving parts come into picture. Like, you can have axles, you can have rails, you can have wheels, and so on and so forth. Well, to the higher carbon side, 0.65, 0.7, we can also have the chisels. Chisel, I need to be high hardness, but at the same time I don't want it to be metal. But unfortunately steels, as I try to increase the hardness, it tends to become metal because cementite is a metal material. So therefore, we control ourselves to around 0.65, 0.7%, where the steel shall have some toughness still there. Then the high carbon steels in the range of 0.8 to 1.4% carbon. This hardness is very high, but at the same time very bitter. The hardness is required sometimes, or many times, whenever we want to do an operation, what is called a cutting operation. I want to cut an object. The object which is cutting, or the tool which is cutting, must be harder than the object. And the highest hardness you find is in the hard diamond. But steels, when we get used to the tools, steels are made of this high carbon steel. They are not as hard as the hard diamond, but they are definitely harder than most materials which you are cutting. So you have blades, you have razors, you have cutting tools, you have saws, you have scissors. So we are not impacting them. A better material can be used, even they can be used. Only thing, you should not drop it or you should not hit it. It will work. All the tools which you are using, the lathe, I think you must have been to the workshop, they're hard. At the same time, quite brittle. If you drop them, they will break. Or hit them with a hammer, they will break. But as long as it's just doing a cutting operation, it will keep working. Okay? Well, if there are problems of impact and jerks and other things coming on the tool, only the cutting edge I can make hard, and just the steel I can make tough. That also I can do. We shall show you this. How can we do it when we come to that? Right? Right now, I'm just talking about the equilibrium diagrams and the equilibrium structures, there are the properties and there are the applications which you put them to. The last thing which I want to use these phase diagrams and tell you about, recall that I discussed a problem in the class that it's not possible for me to get very high purity materials, and therefore engineers are very contented with whatever is possible. We talked about the commercial purity, we have talked about the high purity, ultra high purity, and then the semiconductor rate. How do we get the higher purities? Right? Or mainly for the number matter is semiconductor rate. This we shall try to see with the help of the phase diagram, and I call this process of zone defining. This is a part of the diagram. This is component A, which is my pure component. I want to purify that. And here is the weight percent of B. B is somewhere there. Alright, this is the liquid phase. This is the alpha phase. This is the liquid plus alpha phase field. Let us say, I have this alloy of this composition, which I call C0. I can put in the crucible, take it to the temperature above liquid so that it is all liquid. Bring it, just cool it slowly after that. One can do the stirring, whatever stirring you want to do. Cool it slowly, bring it below the liquid. That is slightly below the liquid. I just show you there, just slightly below the liquid, let us say. I'm going to form a fraction of the solid alpha, which is given by the liberal here. Now that's only the composition of the alpha phase, which I've shown here theoretically this value. But the bad value of alpha, I will have 0% of alpha. I want to have a small quantity of solid, then maybe 0.5% or 1%. I have this composition of the alpha phase which forms. Because the phase, so from the different from liquid, I can mechanically separate it out. Remove the solid particles, drain out the rest of the liquid, throw it. Put these particles back into the crucible, another crucible. Again, melt it. Now you are talking of this composition. You take it to the liquid, other liquid, it will now become liquid. And then cool it below the liquid again, somewhere here. You will get the next solid which solidifies of this composition. Put those with the tweezers, put them in another crucible, drain the rest of the liquid and again melt it. Do it 5-10 times, you can get a very pure solid. You can purify A, but efficiency. What is your efficiency? But let us say I'm picking in 1% every time, because I want to be get very pure solid. So I pick up only 1%. Next time I pick up another 1%. Next time I pick up another 1%. You will pick up a very tiny amount of the pure solid. Most of it is gone into a liquid. But we understood the principle. That's how it is possible for us to get pure form of the solid. Right? So what we do is we exploit this. As engineers, now we'll do the engineering. Let's say I start with, this is the impure solid to start with my initial rod. And here I have a ring heater. Allow this ring heater to travel slowly along the length of the rod. It is circular, annular ring, and come over the rod, it can simply go over. Right? But we do it slowly. Maintain the temperature such that the rod melts, and very, very one stage it is somewhere here, the heater. So under this, whatever is the part of the solid that melts becomes liquid. On the left, the right, it is still a solid. Okay? And then slowly when the heater moves slightly to the right, let us say it goes, and the initial one, let us say, make it slightly to the left. This is the initial one. That's the next step when it goes through. So this liquid has solidified now. This liquid is going to be purer than the melt which is here. And that melt is also not going to be very impure because you are melting a fresh solid also. Right? But definitely that solidified first is purer than the what is in the right. Then as it moves further, solidifies here will be purer than what is on the right. So if I look at here, this I start with this is the length of the rod, and this is the impurity, let us say call it the percentage weight percent B. To start with, this is the weight percentage, uniform throughout the rod. Once I make one pass, this will become very pure here, quite pure, but still impure. I want a still purer form of that, and purity keeps on decreasing, impurity keeps on increasing, and impurity has gone to the inside. If you understand that what solidifies first is purer than what solidifies next. Now I have a rod like this and the heater has reached here. We switch off the heater in and bring it back to the sand. We pass it over actually in a very slow manner. Maybe I will spend almost, if this is a rod of about 10 centimeters, I may take almost a day, pass it slowly, we do it very slowly, so maintain the equilibrium at all places. So then when the second time I do that, okay, this was what is going to melt first. And when that solidifies, it will be still purer. Alright? Let's take black color this thing. It will be still purer. And purity more of this. And after about 5 or 10 passes, the impurity has gone to the right. Pushed to the right because of this. The impurity has lowered the melting point. It is doing so. If the impurity was raising the melting point, then what solidifies first is going to be impure. Right? And what solidifies next is going to be pure. So after this, what you can do is you can just cut off the rod, throw this part. Keep this. This is a larger quantity, and you get a very pure form. Semiconductor grade of silicon is produced like this. It's one of the ways of producing it. And this is called zone refining. All right, we shall start next topic in the next class.